Hello, this is David Strickland, and welcome to the lecture on gender for Sociology of the Family. Today we're going to be thinking about gender and gender roles, what they are, where they came from, and what the consequences of gender roles are for the family. Let's start by looking at some brain scans that show the difference between the male and the female brain. Here we have the female brain, and you can look at the different emphasis at the different parts of the brain. There's a footnote that says, "Put the oil in the car and the be quiet during the game glands are active only when the shiny things and diamonds olfactory has been satisfied or when there is a shoe sale." It looks like large portions of the male brain is set aside to think about sex. And the footnote says, "Listening to children cry in the middle of the night and that gland is not shown due to its small and underdeveloped nature, best viewed under a microscope." I'm sure that you already know that these are mere stereotypes, and that while they're funny, as they're the type of things that standard comedians often point to, they are definitely not true. And the important thing is that you should never feel that you are a certain way or expected to behave and feel and think a certain way just because you're male or female. The truth is that there's a great deal of variety between cultures, and that both males and females exhibit some of the similar traits that we have identified in stereotypes. So let's look at the real social science about gender differences, gender roles, role expectations, and what they have to do with the family. In order to do an adequate job of explaining gender roles, I need to go back and talk with you about the basic concept of status and role. A status is a social position, and a role refers to the expectations that society has for you if you hold that social position. And statuses and roles are a big part of your personal identity. Many of the status positions that we have really define us in terms of the groups to which we belong. Because I can't be a husband unless I have a wife or spouse. I can't be a father unless I have children. I can't be a teacher unless I have students. I can't be a student unless I'm enrolled in a course, and so on. Now, a status is just a social position, like butcher, baker, or candlestick maker, but it could also be other things like tall, short, fat, thin, black, white, Asian, and there are many different types of statuses that each individual holds. An ascribed status is assigned to you involuntarily by society, usually at birth, such as your sex or your race. And other statuses might be achieved statuses, which you acquire at some point during your life. So when you get married, you might acquire the status of husband or wife. And a role is the expectation that society has for individuals who hold particular status positions. The role is prescribed by society, since society suggests what we should do if we hold that status. And as you are socialized from childhood forward, you learn what society's expectations are, and that's your perception of the role. If your perception is the same as what society has for you, then you may behave accordingly and perform that role according to society's expectations. This figure illustrates how that works. Suppose that you have a job as a baker. Then that means you hold the status position of baker. And society's expectation for bakers is that they bake stuff. So the role or the expectation for the status of baker is to bake. Now, a single status could have more than one role. There may be many roles associated with one status. For example, the status of mother has many roles associated with it. I've put two in this figure just to illustrate it, a nurturing role and a discipline role. And all the roles, however many there might be, that are connected to the status of mother would be what we call the role set for the status of mother. Every person holds many different status positions at any given time, and the collection of all the status positions that a person holds at a particular time is what we call the status set for that individual. This figure illustrates the status set. Notice that the sex of an individual is one of the status positions that each of us holds. This is where the concept of gender and gender role emerges in our discussion, because sex is a status that's generally operationalized as male or female, even though there's a very small percentage of people that are born with both sexual characteristics. Gender is the role associated with the status of sex. So the status that we call sex is operationalized as male or female, and the role that we call gender is operationalized in terms of the concepts of masculine or the concepts of feminine within the society. It's important to understand that these gender roles of masculine and feminine are socially constructed through symbolic interaction. What might be considered masculine in one culture might be considered feminine in another culture, and vice versa. For example, the Wodabi men in Africa wear makeup, dress up in fancy dresses to attract the attention of women. That would be considered feminine in the United States, but it's masculine in their culture. In the U.S. society, we only have two genders. One that's associated with males and one that's associated with females. But in some other societies, there are multiple genders. For example, anthropologists have documented third and fourth genders among Native Americans in North America. If you're interested in learning more about that, you can check out the anthropology research of Will Roscoe and his book, Changing Ones, Third and Fourth Genders in Native America. In the United States, we tend to narrowly stereotype men and women into our culturally defined and polarized concepts of masculinity and femininity. These traditional stereotypes are social labels and are really limited in their ability to truly describe individuals, because it's not the case that men and women are polar opposites, as if men are dominant and women are passive and those are two opposite positions. Instead, everyone is dominant to some degree, everyone is passive to some degree, everyone is logical to some degree, everyone is emotional to some degree, and it may be the case that it's more likely that women would score higher on the passive scale and men would score higher on the dominant scale, but there's always going to be women that score higher than some men in dominance and men that score higher than some women in passive. It might also be the case that individual males might attempt to be more dominant because they have socialized that that's the way they're supposed to be, and individual females might attempt to be more passive, emotional, etc., because that's the way they're socialized that they are supposed to be. And this socialization starts when we're very young. For example, when a little boy falls down and skins his knee, we say, don't be a crybaby, don't cry. Boys don't cry. But when a little girl falls down and skins her knee, we say, oh, poor little baby, let's wipe those crocodile tears away, let's kiss the boo-boo and make it better, and so on and so forth. So we reinforce and teach and socialize children to be what our stereotypes of masculine and feminine are. And they conform to those to some degree. And to some degree, that socialization explains why people behave the way that they do. It's not surprising that the gender role stereotypes were narrowly defined for children prior to the second wave of the feminist movement, you know, prior to, say, the 1960s. But I found this article in a blog by a self-proclaimed feminist entrepreneur woman who, in 2010, felt like she wasn't getting her feminist message across to her child, that somehow the larger society was still socializing her little girl, that there were limitations to what little girls could do. Let's take a look at that blog. I think you'll enjoy it. She writes, "I am a female entrepreneur with a tech company, a working mom with a 3-year-old daughter, and I try to instill good feminist values in my little girl. I tell her all the time that she can be anything she wants to be when she grows up. How she got it into her head that she couldn't be a doctor is beyond me. My 3-year-old loves playing doctor with her dolls and her stuffed animals, so for Christmas, I bought her the closest thing to a doctor's kit that I could find in our small community, a Melissa and Doug's veterinarian kit. You be the patient, mommy, and I'll be the nurse, she told me recently. Why not be the doctor, baby? I asked. She laughed at me as if to say, crazy, mommy. Then she said, girls can't be doctors, mommy. Only boys can be doctors. Long pause. Many internal freak out. Honey, girls can be doctors too, I assured her. Oh no, mommy, they can't. Girls can only be nurses, she replied. Sweetie, boys can be nurses and girls can be doctors, I replied. She laughed and laughed. You're funny, mommy. Where did I go wrong? After a few more exchanges, I realized that I could not convince my little girl that she indeed could be a doctor if she wanted to be one. Once the internal shock of my obvious failure as a feminist mom wore off, my next thought was, who can I blame? Who told my little girl that she couldn't be a doctor and her only option was nurse? I was ready to march right up to them, get in their face, and tell them they'd better never ever tell my daughter she can't be a doctor if she damn well pleases. Can I blame the princesses? I have yet to figure out who told her girls not to be doctors, but then I begin to scrutinize the books and the DVDs on the bookshelf. Somewhere in the dozens upon dozens of books and movies, there had to be some images of women in non-traditional roles, right? Wrong. I found representations of women as mommies, teachers, camp counselors, princesses, queens, fairy godmothers, witches, no doctors, no travelers, and adventurers, unless Dora counts, no female construction workers, or female truck drivers, or female scientists, or female heads of internet companies. Okay, she's only 3. However, I was floored to realize that the majority of female characters in the media she is consuming are animals, and mostly other mother bears, and mother seals, and mother ducks, etc. I know there are feminist fairy tales, but what are some of the other books out there for a smart little girl who should believe she can be anything? What are the books you're reading to your kids to let them know they can be anything? When I emphasize the socialization aspect of the development of particular personalities, then I'm using the symbolic interaction or the interactionist perspective or paradigm to try to understand gender behaviors and the definition of gender within our society. Naturally, parents are the primary influencers of children when they're very young, but other groups and institutions within society have a great deal of influence on children and how they are socialized, including their gender socialization. At a certain point, they look to their peers for approval and buy into a socialization that is promoted by their peers. In addition, institutions and societies such as schools and religious organizations contribute to gender socialization. So all of these things in society together contribute to the socialization of children and their development of their gender roles. So that's the basic interactionist approach to explaining gender role socialization. But how would you explain the longevity of gender role stereotypes if you use the structural functional paradigm or functionalism. Functionalists use the terms instrumental and expressive to describe complementary roles that have emerged over time for males and females within the society. These roles work together to help keep society stable. Over time, slight modifications to those roles may emerge in order to serve society better. This brings us to conflict theory. How would you explain gender role stereotypes using the conflict paradigm? The basic idea of conflict theory is that there are different social groups that are in competition for limited resources associated with wealth, power, and prestige. And the fact that some groups have more opportunity to acquire those things, wealth, power, prestige, then the conflict ensues between dominant groups with more opportunity and subordinate groups that have less opportunities. And there's usually an ideology in the society that most people buy into that really is a rationale as to why things are the way they are and why it's okay for there to be even great amounts of inequality and stratification. In our study of the family, we might employ the conflict paradigm by considering what ways men and women constitute the competing social groups of the conflict, and in what ways gender roles might promote inequality or influence the struggle between men as a group and women as a group in the family. So the conflict theorist would examine how gender roles contribute to gender stratification or inequality of opportunity and access to resources associated with wealth, power, and prestige for women in society. And conflict theorists would point to the fact that gender inequality can be seen both in the workforce and in the family. Gender roles generally establish men as the dominant group and women as the subordinate group in family life. So conflict theorists might identify gender roles as part of a larger ideology that supports the stratification system and ensures that it will be maintained over time. One example of how gender roles support inequality in the family has to do with household work. So gender roles are the traditional stereotypical gender role model. Supports inequality in the type of household work. So the types of household chores allocated to women in the traditional gender role model are less prestigious. They'd be the nasty ones, tasks that must be done repeatedly every day and might be considered more unpleasant. Those are the nasty ones, such as changing diapers, washing dishes, cleaning toilets, and many more from a long list. Meanwhile, many of the chores assigned to men in the traditional model include things like maintaining the car, the lawn, conducting general repairs, things that might fall into the more nice category, and things that can be done when you have time to do them. In this video, we talked about status and roles, and in particular, gender roles, and we looked at which we explained that using the symbolic interaction paradigm and the functionalist paradigm and the conflict paradigm. Now, here are some other questions that we might want to ask about gender roles and their impact on various aspects of family life. How do gender roles affect dating? How do they affect communication in marriage? How do gender roles affect domestic duties? We have talked about that. And how do gender roles affect a couple's sexual relationship?